Good day, everyone, and welcome to ISA's web seminar, Introduction to Process Control. Your seminar materials include a downloadable presentation, a question and answer session, and a Zoom Ring seminar survey, which will be sent to your email box to complete immediately following the seminar. You earn 1.5 PDH for attending. Also, as a note to attendees, this seminar will be recorded. Today's seminar is 90 minutes in length. There will be three 10-minute question and answer sessions. As a participant, you are in a listen-only mode. You may ask questions via the internet using your keyboard at any time during the presentation. However, the presenter may decide to wait to answer your question until the next Q&A session. If you have audio difficulties, press star zero. Questions may be asked via your telephone line. Press the star 1 key on your telephone keypad to ask a question. If there are no other callers on the line, the operator will announce your name and affiliation to the audience and then ask for your question. If other participants are asking questions, you will be placed into a queue until you are first in line. While in queue, you will be in a listen-only mode until the operator indicates that your phone has been activated. The operator will announce your name and affiliation and then ask for your question. We will now begin today's seminar with a brief introduction of our speaker, Mr. William Shaw. William Shaw has over 30 years of experience with computer-based automation systems, including developing three generations of BCS systems and two generations of SCADA systems. Former adjunct professor in graduate engineering department of Loyola College in Baltimore, authored books on batch process control and on SCADA cybersecurity. Currently the senior consultant for cybersecurity consulting and industrial automation cybersecurity firm. Tim periodically teaches courses for ISA and IEEE. And now, William Shaw.
Thank you, Tiffany, and welcome, everyone. We've got some goals to achieve today. Our overall goal for this training session is to basically start off by discussing the operation and components of what is called a feedback control loop. In fact, we're going to try to explain to you why we call it a loop. We're going to talk a bit about the role of measurement and control in industrial processes. And we're going to try to interpret and explain what is meant by measurement and control technology. And we're going to get into a little bit of a discussion about some basic concepts of process controllers, controller tuning, and how it all plays together. So we've got a lot to cover in the next 90 minutes. We're going to begin in section one by a discussion of some basic process control terminology. We're going to try to discuss and explain what we mean by a process and also by process control. We're going to discuss the most elemental part of process control, something called a loop. And loops basically have two basic components. Part of it is the measurement aspect of it, and we're going to discuss that, and also the control aspect of it. We're going to talk about something called a set point, what it is, why it's important. And we're going to break down the execution of process control loops into sort of a set of basic steps. First of all, the making of a measurement of a controlled variable of something we care about, comparing that to this thing called a set point and seeing if it's where we want it to be. If not, making some decisions about how to make an adjustment, maybe move a valve or turn on a blower or turn on or off an electric heater to try and correct things to make the measurement that we're taking come back in line with this set point. And we're also going to talk about something called P&I drawings or P&I diagrams, process and instrumentation, or some people say piping and instrumentation. In other words, a methodology for documenting all of this stuff that we're going to be talking about. So what is the formal definition of a process? You know, in the most basic terms, a process is where we take material and or energy, we do something to it, and generate something different. You have process control going on in your home all the time. This diagram, we show a very simple example. If you have an air conditioner at home, it takes hot air in, does something to it, and puts cold air out. If you have a hot water heater, then you take cold water in, and it does something to it, heats it up, and gives you hot water out. These are processes. These are fundamental basic processes. And processes are part of what is required in a manufacturing or production plant. When we talk about a process, it's usually, again, one or more steps involved in converting something coming into something we need. Usually it's not going to be as simple as the hot water heater. That's about as simple a process as I could think of, where we merely take a particular substance and change its temperature, add, you know, heat to it. Obviously, there are industrial processes that are far more complicated. You know, if we have a refinery, crude oil comes in at one end, and an awful lot of different processing steps occur that generally end up resulting in distilled petroleum products like gasoline, kerosene, and asphalt coming at the other end. Essentially, process steps are put in series to take, again, things coming in and convert them as necessary. Even a manufacturing operation works that way. You know, if you look at a automobile factory, you know, parts come in one end, cars go out the other end, and there's an awful lot of welding and screwing and bolting and painting and things that have to occur. These are all what we call process steps. Now, a manufacturing operation is slightly different from a process plant because it's not actually continuous. And we're going to be discussing principally what are called continuous processes. Now, let's take this process and sort of accessorize it a bit. Because the desire is that we just don't have things like cold water coming in and hot water coming out. We have to control that. If you were to just turn on the heater in your hot water heater and let it run continuously, you wouldn't get just hot water. You'd get boiling hot water. In fact, steam might be coming out of your shower head rather than hot water, and that would be unacceptable. You want to raise the cold water to a certain temperature, you know, not hot enough to scald you and injure you, but hot enough to make sure that you can have a nice hot shower. So you want to actually control the amount of heat that you put into that. Well, this is what we talk about when we say process control in a control loop. Well, we've got something coming in, like cold air or hot air or cold water. We perform a processing operation on it, such as in the furnace we add heat to the air, or in a hot water heater we heat the water up. And then the water comes out, and we measure that water. We measure that hot water. There's a thermostat, for example, that's hooked up to your furnace, and there's also a thermostat in your hot water heater, something that says, yeah, that the temperature is where we want it to be, or no, it's too low. And if the temperature is too low, that signal goes back to, quote-unquote, a controller, and that's really what a thermostat is in to some degree as well. And it sends a signal to, in the case of your furnace, the burner that says, no, we're not hot enough. Turn on that furnace heater and, you know, heat the air a little more, or tell the hot water heater, turn on that electric coil, or turn on, again, maybe a gas hot water on the burner, and raise the temperature again. Keep going up. And once the temperature of the hot air or the hot water reaches the desired value, then the thermostat and the sensor in the thermostat send a signal back, sort of saying, okay, you can turn off the electric heater, you can turn off the burner. That process of something coming in, we make a change to it, we measure the effect of that change to see if it's where we want it to be. If not, we send a signal saying, no, keep going, keep doing whatever it is you're doing to adjust this process. That is what we call a control loop, and that's why it's called a control loop. And part of a control loop is this thing we referred to at the beginning called a set point. If you have a thermostat on your wall and you dial in the temperature that you want, that temperature setting is called the set point. You're saying, I want the temperature in this room to be 75 degrees. And the thermostat, which is the controller in this particular case, senses the temperature in the room. There's actually usually a little bimetallic strip inside that thermostat. And it says, yep, the temperature is at or above 75 degrees. Everything's fine. Or nope, the temperature is below that. And if the temperature is below that, it sends a signal down to the furnace to cause the furnace to turn on. That is a control loop, and we use control loops all the time. Basically, in your house, you've got several of them. The controller that turns the furnace on and off, the thermostat, that's one of them. In your hot water heater, you have a control loop that heats the water up to a certain temperature but not beyond that. Even in the oven in your kitchen, that when you set the temperature to bake at 375 degrees, you're basically doing continuous loop feedback control. All right, so we'll build on this concept. When we talk about a process control loop, we really can break it into two pieces. There's the measurement side of it, and then there's the control side of it. in the case of measurement, we are taking a measurement of what's called the controlled or measured variable. In a hot water heater, the measured variable is the temperature of the water coming out of the hot water heater. In the case of a furnace, the temperature in the room where the thermostat's located, that room temperature, the air temperature, is the controlled or measured variable. We call it the controlled variable because we can change it. We can change the temperature of the air in the room. We can change the temperature of the hot water coming out of the hot water heater by performing additional control actions. Now, the controller is, again, like the thermostat on your wall, the device that says, well, I know what the temperature is he wants, the set point value. I'm measuring what the temperature is. If they're not the same, I'm going to send a control action. And in the case of a thermostat and a hot water heater, all that means is it turns on the heating coil. In the case of a furnace, it tells the furnace to turn on. So the control element that we're showing on the control side, the control element is whatever it is we're manipulating to impact this measured variable. So in the case of a hot water heater, it's the electric heating coil that we turn on to heat the water. In the case of the furnace, it's the gas burner that we're causing to come on and ignite to change and heat up the temperature of the air. So we have a measurement side, and we have a control element side, and then sort of sitting between the two, we have this thing we call a controller. Now, a thermostat is as simple a control device as possible. It basically says if the temperature is at or above the set point, nothing has to be done. If it's below the set point, then we turn on the control element. It sends a simple contact signal. You could replace a thermostat with a switch, and, you know, if you think the room's hot enough, turn the switch off. If it's not hot enough, flip the switch on, and you could become your own controller. But we don't want to have to stand in the room all day doing that, so in fact, we usually set up some kind of electronic device to do that. As I said, you've got lots of situations of control in your house. Believe it or not, your toilet performs control. In your toilet, you have a float ball in the back, and as long as the water level in the tank is high enough, that float valve turns off the control element, which is the valve that lets water into your toilet tank. You flush the toilet, the water level drops, the ball drops, that opens the valve and allows water to come back in until your toilet level is brought back up again. So believe it or not, even if you're not in a factory, just in your own home, you've got lots of cases of process control loops. Now, when we talk about process control, we really usually break it into four activities. We talked about the measurement and the control, but we really have four different activities. The first is to make an accurate measurement of this controlled variable, of this thing we want to control. And it's important to make an accurate measurement. If your thermostat is broken, if the temperature control on your oven is broken, then you could end up with a room that's way too hot or way too cold, or you could end up burning your brownies because the oven temperature is way off. You want an accurate measurement. So we need some way to measure the control variable. And this usually involves some type of sensor device that has a physical response to the control variable. In old-style thermostats, that would have been a coil of bimetallic metal that would literally bend based on temperature differences. As temperature went up and down, the coil would bend a bit or shrink back a bit, and that physical movement of the sensor could be used to close a contact. Today we also then would take that measurement and turn it into an electrical signal that can be sent somewhere to a control room, for example, and we use a device called a transmitter. Now the second step after we have an accurate measurement is to compare that measurement to the desired set point. So if I want the oven to be at 350 degrees or I want my room at 75 degrees, that is my set point value. So I take this process measurement and I compare it to the set point, and the question is simple. Do we have a difference between them? Is the actual measurement higher than or lower than my set point desired value? And based on being higher or lower than in actual industrial control, we then have what's called a control algorithm. It looks at that difference, which is usually called the error, and it makes a decision. It has to decide, based on how big that error is, what to do. For example, if I want to raise the temperature in the room just a little bit, I don't have to do very much. But if I come into the room and the room is freezing cold and I want to bring it up by 30 degrees, then we might need to take a big control action. So the control algorithm looks at the difference between the set point that we want and the actual measurement that we're getting, and then decides to make a control action take place, and how big and how much and how fast that control action we're going to take it tends to be is going to be based on how the control algorithm is set up. And the controller then, again, sends some type of a signal to a final control element. In this particular case, the diagram might be showing the final element is a valve, and therefore the signal we're sending might be used to open the valve fully or close the valve fully, or maybe to just adjust the valve to be slightly more or less open. So these four steps of measure, compare, decide what kind of action to take, and then sending signal and performing that action, these are the four steps that are part of a basic process control loop. Now let's look at a more realistic example and forget things in your home. In a real industrial process, a very common thing that we need to do, one of the processing steps quite often, is to either heat or cool material or liquids. In this particular case, we're showing a diagram of a heat exchanger. Now, a heat exchanger is nothing more than, think of it as a tank that we can put hot water or steam in one side and it flows through and flows out the other side. And at the same time in that tank, we have another set of piping that's completely isolated through which we carry product. So in this example, we've got product, maybe it's, soft drink ingredients or something, or maybe just water, coming in the top of the heat exchanger, going through the heat exchanger and coming out the bottom. So the heat exchanger is going to cause us to either heat or cool. And in this particular case, we're putting steam through the heat exchanger. So we're heating. The assumption here is we're going to bring the temperature of our product up. So we're going to have products flowing through the heat exchanger. The desired measurement value is the temperature of this product as it leaves the heat exchanger. So that's where we've got our sensor and transmitter to make a temperature measurement. Right? So product is flowing through. And then if the product temperature coming out is too cold or too hot, we want to adjust the flow of steam through the heat exchanger. And we have a valve at the front end of the heat exchanger that controls the flow of steam. And by opening that valve a little bit more, closing it a bit, we can reduce or increase the flow of steam and thus the amount of heat put into the product and therefore change the temperature up or down of the product coming out of the heat exchanger. And, of course, we have a signal that's going from our transmitter to a controller device. Now, this would probably be back in the control room somewhere, and the controller would have some indicators on the front of what the actual temperature is, what the desired set point value is. And then the controller itself has to send a signal to move the valve. Now, most valves are not going to be operated by electricity. There are valves that can be operated by electricity. We'll talk about them. But most valves, especially valves that are what are called modulated valves, valves you can adjust them a little bit. You can open them up a little bit or close them a little bit. Those usually work off of air pressure. And so the controller is going to put out an electrical signal, but that signal has to be converted into air pressure. Now, on this diagram, we've got several things happening. We have a sensor, a transmitter device that's taking a measurement of our product and turning that measurement into an electrical signal that it can send through the wires as our process variable to this controller. The controller probably has some knobs on the front that I can dial up and down to set the desired temperature or set point. And the controller puts out an electrical signal that goes out and then gets converted somehow into an air pressure signal that operates the valve. And what we have shown in the upper left-hand corner is a circle with the strange lettering I/P. That's an indication that we've got a device here that's converting current flow, the I, into P or pressure. So this is something called a transducer. And we feed it with high-pressure air, and what it puts out is air pressure between 3 and 15 PSIG that is used to manipulate the steam valve. So this is an actual example of what would be far more realistic in an industrial process, and we have a control loop going on here, okay? Now, we could draw this differently. Let's say we wanted to document all this, and maybe you're a really good artist, so you can, you know, stand back and draw a really great picture. So you draw a picture of what the heat exchanger looks like, and you show the pipes, you know, carrying steam in at one end and the condensate the, you know, out the other end, and you show the pipes that show where the product flows in, and you don't show inside, but, you know, you show the product flowing out. Then you've got another set of drawing symbols here that indicate that there's a temperature sensor, probably a thermocouple mounted on that outgoing product pipe, and a wire that goes to some controller, maybe in the control room mounted on a panel, and wires that leave it going out to this thing that's going to do the current-to-pressure I-to-P conversion. And you show the valves, and you label it all, and there you go. You've created some documentation. And luckily, you're a really good artist, so you've been able to draw this up wonderfully. Unfortunately, you work with other people who aren't so good as artists, so when they try to draw up things that they're doing, it doesn't come out so well. The problem is that unless you're a really good artist, drawing all this stuff up and also making sure that it indicates everything that's important is kind of difficult. And therefore, we have standards. We have developed a very standardized set of symbologies that are used to document industrial processes. And in fact, that brings us to the next diagram, something called P&I diagrams. Piping and instrumentation, or process and instrumentation diagrams. The symbols on this drawing that I'm showing you right now represent the process we just looked at. That symbol in the middle, the big circle that shows a line kind of zigzagging through it, plus another pair of lines that show going in and going out, but nothing in the middle, that is the symbol for a heat exchanger. So we show the pair of pipes that carry the steam in and the condensate out, and the pair of pipes that show the liquid, the product that goes in, presumably then gets heated inside the heat exchanger and leaves. That symbol for a heat exchanger is universal. If I look at anybody's P&I diagram and see that symbol, I know that's a heat exchanger. Now, there's also symbols for the valve. We have a symbol here that shows that valve is controlling steam flow, and there's several things about that symbol that are very important. For example, the valve has this stem that looks like an arrow pointing downwards. And in fact, that tells me a very important thing. It tells me that that valve is designed to fail closed. In other words, that valve is operated by air pressure. Well, if somebody were to cut the line and kill the air pressure, that valve won't stay where it is. It will actually fail closed, which is a safety consideration. The valve itself has a head that kind of looks like a semicircle. That shape tells me something. That shape tells me that that's an air-operated valve. And, in fact, if I wasn't sure of that, the fact that there's a line going into it that has a double hash, that's the symbology that indicates that that's an air line. That's not an electrical wire. Now, if we go back to the heat exchanger, there's a symbol sort of on the right middle of the page, a circle that says TT213. Well, this loop might be one of hundreds of loops in the process plant itself. So we've designated this loop and all of the elements of this loop to be loop 213. TT tells me that this circle is indicating that I have a temperature transmitter. So this is a temperature measurement thing, and it is a transmitter device. And what comes out of it, going up to the top, is a dashed line. That dashed line indicates that this is an electrical signal. So a dashed line indicates electrical, and in the process control world, we have standards. A transmitter device is going to put out an electrical signal that varies between 4 and 20 milliamperes of DC power as a way of representing the measurement that it's taking. So we know that we have a temperature, and we're representing that temperature as a current flow. Now, that temperature is our measured variable, and it goes up through electrical wiring to another circle that says TIC213, and it has a line through the middle. Well, that line through the middle tells me that this is a controller that's on my main control panel in my control room. And believe it or not, that's what the line says. TIC says this is a temperature indicating controller, meaning that if I walk up to the control panel, this controller has a faceplate on it, probably some bar graphs, and I can actually see the temperature and I can see the set point. This controller puts out a signal. Again, it's an electrical signal. It's a dashed line, 4 to 20 milliamps, and that signal goes to another circle that's labeled TY. Well, Y means it's some type of function. Again, T says it's a temperature control loop, and we have this little square that says I to P. So this is an indication that what I've got there is a device that's taking a 4 to 20 electrical signal in and converting it to an air pressure signal of 3 to 15 PSI, And that is what's going through a pipe. That's what the straight line with the double dash across it means, an air pipe into the valve and operating that valve. So all of these particular symbols on this diagram, this part of this P&I diagram, are telling me specifically about what I'm looking at. So these are standard symbols that have been defined by the ISA, and pretty much in industry, if you pick up a P&I diagram, you can read it and make sense out of what's going on once you learn what these symbols mean and the methodologies we use in documenting things. All right, so again, in a process control loop, we've got several steps. We've got the making of a measurement of a variable we care about, like temperature, pressure, flow. We need to standardize its representation into some electrical form, like 4 to 20 milliamps, or even into an air pressure form of 3 to 15 psi. We have to send that to a controller where we compare it to a desired value called a set point. Based on the difference between the measurement and the set point, we've got an error, and we've got to decide what to do about that error. How much in this particular case to adjust the valve? Do we have a huge error and we have to slam that valve wide open or maybe close the valve completely? Or can we just open it or close it just a little bit more or less? And how long do we have or how quickly do we need to act? And then, of course, putting out a control change, changing that electrical or air pressure signal to the valve to make it happen. So these are all part of the steps. Now, not all process control is done in this manner. It's not all continuous control. There are other types of control, and we'll discuss them. I always like to talk about standing in the shower and trying to keep the shower temperature the way we like it as a good example of a process control loop. You're standing in the shower. When you first got in the shower, you adjusted the hot and cold water to get it just the way you wanted, and you're standing there very comfortable, and someone in the house flushes the toilet. So all of a sudden, the cold water pressure drops, the water in your shower gets way too hot, and you have to do something. So you grab either the hot water or the cold water, maybe you grab the hot water, and you quickly turn it down. So the likelihood that that adjustment you just made being exactly right that brings the temperature just back where you want it aren't too good. You're probably going to end up standing there for a while, then tweaking it up a little bit and down a little bit until you adjust the way you really want it again, and you've accommodated for this pressure drop. Then, of course, a little later, the toilet that was flushed fills up and stops taking water, and now all of a sudden the water pressure for cold water goes up, and it's too cold, and you've got to make adjustments in the other direction. This is exactly what a process controller and control loop is doing continuously. And that's why we call it a feedback loop, because we make an adjustment, we see how that changes. So we tweak the hot water, we wait a second or two and see if it gets warm enough. Nope, tweak it a bit more. Okay, all right, it's nice now. Oh, my God, it's gotten cold. Okay, it's gotten too hot. Quick, tweak the water temperature down by, again, adjusting the hot water. This process of making continuous adjustments to try to maintain the desired temperature or desired pressure or flow is what we call a feedback control loop. Right? So it's feedback because we take the measurement, we look at the set point, we decide if it's right, and if not, we go and we adjust our valve to try and correct it, and we keep doing that over and over until things are right. Now, again, no adjustment's going to occur until a deviation is taking place. In other words, if you're standing in the shower and nobody's flushing toilets and the temperature is just fine, then there's no reason to make any adjustment or take control action. It's only when a deviation in the process, a perturbation occurs, such as somebody flushing the toilet or maybe turning on the faucet in the kitchen, that you then have to take control action. And when there is such a change, generally there's a certain amount of time between you making the control adjustment and it having the proper effect. There's usually something called a time lag, a first-order time lag. All right, so in this first section, we've talked a bit about terminology. We've discussed what a process is and a little bit about process control. We've discussed process control loops. We've discussed the fact that we need to be able to make accurate measurements and then represent those measurements in some standardized format, which, again, in the process world tends to either be an electrical signal of 4 to 20 milliamps or a pressure signal of 3 to 15 psi. We talked about the control side, where we send a signal out then and adjust a control element, like opening and closing a valve. We discussed set points. We talked about those different steps in this process of measure, compare, decide if we need to take control action and then doing that. And we discussed P&I diagrams as a way of documenting all of this stuff. All right, at this point in time, that brings us up to the end of the first section. So, Tiffany, can I turn it back to you, and let's see if there's any questions.
Yes, sir. At this time, I would like to remind everyone, if you would like to ask a question via the phone line, please press star, then the number 1. Again, that is star 1. We'll pause for just a moment to compile the Q&A roster. And at this time, sir, there are currently no questions from the phone lines.
All right. Thank you, Tiffany. All right, everyone, we'll go ahead then and go into section number 2. I do want to just tell you, though, if a question comes up later, you're not restricted to just asking about the section we just finished. So don't feel like, oh, I just thought of the question I should have asked. You can ask it when we get to the next Q&A session. So let's get into section number 2, the actual loop measurement process. As I said, it's very important to take accurate measurements. A gentleman who is sort of famous in the process control world and lived many years ago, a gentleman named Lord Kelvin, said that you cannot control something unless you can accurately measure it. And that's pretty much true. For us to be able to do control, we have to take measurements and we have to know that they're accurate. We measure lots of different things. So we're going to talk about the different kinds of variables that we might want to make and measure. We're going to talk about instruments, devices that are used to actually turn a variable like a temperature, pressure, flow, level, and turn those into electrical signals. We're going to talk about those instruments and how they have to be calibrated for accuracy. We're going to talk about standard representations. We're going to discuss something called engineering units and percentage of scale. We're going to talk a little bit about the accuracy and repeatability, two different aspects of making measurements, and we'll discuss a couple of other measurement terminologies, and we're going to discuss a bit towards the end of the section the issues of ranging and instrument calibration. So let's start off with process variables. Basically, in most processes, there are going to be things we want to control that are very important for the process to work properly. As I mentioned, if the temperature in your oven isn't maintained properly, you don't get, you know, nice brownies. You either get melted slop or you get burnt, charred coal. So we've got lots of things we need to measure. And some of the more common measurements are flow, level, pressure, temperature. But there are many, many more. You know, we can measure the density, the pH, the viscosity, turbidity, clarity, even reactivity. There's lots of different physical parameters that we might need to measure and control in our process. And again, we can't control them if we can't measure them. So the beginning point in everything is accurate measurement of the process variables. Okay? Now, flow is a very common process measurement. We measure flow for lots and lots of purposes, and flow can be measured many different ways. And I'm mentioning this because many of these other parameters we're going to talk about, whether it's level, pressure, density, et cetera, can be measured in a variety of different ways. Sometimes we have measurements that are direct. For example, in the case of flow, you can do what's called a volumetric measurement. There are pumps that actually, each time they cycle, they move a very specific controlled amount of liquid or gas. They work in terms of, you know, cubic feet or gallons per stroke. So by counting strokes and using something like a positive or PD pump, we can totally control our volumetric flow. But we can work off of other things. I don't know if any of you, when you were young, you know, had pinwheels, and now we've got those annoying ads on TV of a squealing pig. But, you know, a pinwheel is essentially a little wind vane that if you blow into it softly, it turns slowly. If you blow into it really fast and hard, it spins faster. In measurement of flow, we can use things, for example, like turbine meters, where actually the turbine, the blades are submerged in the gas or liquid, and as the flow rate increases or decreases, the turbine spins faster or more slowly. There's also inferential ways of measuring flow rate. If you've ever held a garden hose in your hand and you turn your water on, and if you turn on slowly, just a little bit, the water kind of, you know, comes out and dribbles out the end of the hose. But if you turn the water on all the way, you know, the water might gush out several inches. Well, if you think about it, if you wanted to mount a hose pipe somewhere and put a scale, or, you know, a ruler above it, and take some measurements, you could effectively use the distance out from the hose, the end of the hose, as the water squirts as an indicator of the water flow rate or the water pressure even. That's not a direct measurement. That's an inferential measurement. In fact, one of the most common ways of measuring flow is by using something called differential pressure, or DP, where we take a pipe and we actually put a blockage in the pipe. What it usually boils down to is we take a disc with a hole cut in the middle, and the shape and placement of the hole has some effect. But we bolt this into the middle of the pipe so that basically the liquid coming down the pipe hits this and has to squeeze through the hole. And if we measure the pressure on both sides of this impediment, the differential pressure, that pressure is directly related to the square of the flow rate of the liquid. So by creating a pressure differential, we can actually create an inferential measurement of flow. And flow is just, again, one of the measurements. Another very common measurement is pressure. Now, pressure is stated in the form of force per unit area. So when we talk about pressure, we usually talk about it in terms of pounds per cubic foot. Now, there are standards for this, and in fact, in the early days of scientific methodologies, when people were just beginning to understand the concepts of measurement, if you were to take a box that was exactly 1 foot by 1 foot by 1 foot and fill it with water, now here we're talking about nice, pure, clean water, at a temperature of 60 degrees Fahrenheit, and set that box on a scale to measure it, you would find that water, that cubic foot of water, weighs 62.4 pounds. Pounds, I know, is a measurement of weight, but really it's a measurement of force. If you remember your high school physics, force is equal to mass times acceleration. We have gravitational acceleration. So when we say something weighs so many pounds, what we really mean is that it's an exerting downward force of that much based on its mass and gravity. So we've got this cubic foot of water that weighs 62.4 pounds. Right. Well, that's the amount of weight that's pressing down over a 12-inch by 12-inch or 144-square-inch area. If we divide that, we can say that 62.4 pounds of pressure is pressing down on 144 square inches, or put it a different way, if we had a 1-inch square, 1-foot-high column of water, it would exert a downward pressure of 0.433 pounds per square inch. And in fact, that's sometimes referred to as a foot of water. And in many different process industries, such as the water wastewater industry, people use the concept of feet of water as a pressure measurement. So if somebody says, oh, we've got, 14 feet of head pressure, what they really are saying is not that there's 14 feet of water, but that the pressure they're measuring is equivalent to the pressure that would be created by a column of water 14 feet high. And since we know that 1 foot gives me 0.433 pounds, we can multiply that by 14 and kind of get an idea of how much pressure that is. So pressure is another type of measurement. Another very common measurement is level. And when we talk about level, we can either be thinking about level in terms of where is the actual liquid-gas interface in a tank. What do I mean by liquid-gas interface? Well, the level in your bathtub. your bathroom is not in a vacuum. There's air. There's atmosphere in your room. It's full of air. Right? And in fact, atmosphere has a certain downward pressure that we have to adjust for and accommodate sometimes. But the point is, you want to know how many inches from the top edge of the bathtub is where the water level is. So sometimes level is a measurement of how far up from the bottom or down from the top of a tank our interface is in it as that. So, whether we've got another foot or two in the tank before we start overflowing or whether we're getting down to the bottom of the tank. Sometimes what we care about in level measurement is how much. How many gallons of liquid are in this tank. So we might be dealing with, a distance measurement of level or a quantity or volumetric measure of level. Temperature is a common measurement. And in fact, we've got several different measurement schemes. The one that we tend to use here in the United States is the Fahrenheit scale. And in the Fahrenheit scale, Water freezes at 32 degrees Fahrenheit and boils at 212 degrees Fahrenheit. And if you try to figure out how far down in that scale you've got to get to reach what's referred to as absolute zero, you'd find you've got to go 459.69 degrees negative to be able to get to absolute zero. Actually, to accommodate this, there's a different measurement scale called the Rankine scale. That's the one at the far right. This is actually a Fahrenheit scale adjusted downwards so that absolute zero is called zero rather than minus 459. And in that case, water freezes at 491 degrees absolute and water boils at 671.69 degrees absolute. A more common scale in the rest of the world, certainly in Europe, and also when we're dealing in scientific measures, is the Celsius scale or degrees C. In the Celsius, or sometimes called centigrade scale, water freezes at zero and boils at 100. And incidentally, that's also why it's called centigrade, 100 graduations between freezing and boiling of water. So that's kind of how it gets its name. The point is that we can take the exact same temperature measurement and express it in multiple ways. So if I'm an American and I stick a thermometer in an ice cube, I'm going to say, well, that ice cube is 32 degrees. If you're European, you're going to say, no, it's zero. You know, if you're Lord Kelvin, you're going to say, no, it's 273 degrees. The point is they're all correct. It's just that their basis is different. And so sometimes we have to deal in measurements of temperatures in different scales. But they can all be fortunately converted linearly from one to the other. So if I know a temperature in Fahrenheit, I have a simple math formula that will convert it to degrees C and vice versa. So this brings us actually to a different kind of concept, and that is how to represent something. I can't send a temperature over a wire. I can only send an electrical signal over a wire. And electrical signals are measured in either volts or current. They're not measured in temperature. And yet I've got a temperature measurement, and I need to send that measurement, you know, to the other side of a plant, to a control room, to a controller or a computer. And I can't send temperature. I can only send an electrical signal. So we have to have some way of representing the engineering unit's temperature in an electrical manner. Now, you do this all the time, whether you know it or not. I'm sure that most of you on the phone call today own a car or have driven a car, and you have a gas gauge. Well, your gas gauge generally is a meter that goes from E, meaning empty, to F, meaning full, and it probably has a marker somewhere that says, you know, here's quarter tank, you know, half tank, three-quarters tank, and full. Well, empty and full are handy because we certainly don't want to run out of gas or want to know that we've got a lot of gas. But, in fact, if I knew the shape and dimensions of your gas tank, I could figure out how many gallons of gas you have when you're full, and obviously at empty it should be zero, and how much in between it would be, and I could change your gas gauge, and I could erase the E's and F's and write gallons and put gallon figures next to those half and three-quarters and quarter tank positions. And then I could claim that this is not a, you know, a fuel tank gauge. It's a gallons of gas gauge. It's just a matter of how I label it. Well, in the process control world, when we talk about a measurement instrument that measures a process value, like a temperature or pressure, that sensor has to then go into something called a transmitter. And a transmitter is usually an electrical or pneumatic, an electromechanical device that is going to convert some range of that of the temperature sensor into an electrical or pressure signal. And in the U.S., in the process control world, we generally use 4 milliamperes to 20 milliamperes of an electrical variation of signal to represent the engineering unit range of a measurement device. So if I've got a temperature transmitter and I only care about temperature of, let's say, 0 to 100 degrees centigrade. In other words, I only care about water from freezing to boiling. And then I would take that sensor device, which maybe it is a thermometer. It's probably not going to be. It's probably going to be some thermistor or some other sensitive device that produces some electrical signal based on temperature. And I'm going to put it through some circuitry that generates a 4 to 20 milliampere signal linearly as the temperature goes up or down from 0 to 100 degrees C. and then that electrical signal can be sent through wires through my plant to my controllers. In some cases, we can't use electrical signals. Sometimes electricity is dangerous. If we've got an explosive hazard area, we don't want to use electricity. So another way that has been used for years is to use air pressure. We have different types of transmitter devices that will take temperature, pressure, level, flow, and represent them as air pressure. And the standard for air pressure in the U.S. is 3 psi to 15 psi, which equates to 20 kilopascals or kPas to 100 kPas using the European scheme. So I've got basically a meter, you could say, a gauge, and this gauge goes from, you know, from empty to full or 0 to 100%, and that gauge can be labeled many different ways. And that gauge can represent engineering units, like labeling your gas tank with gallons rather than empty to full. And we represent those signals to transmit them across a plant using either air pressure or an electrical signal in the forms of 3 to 15 psi or 4 to 20 milliamps. So, our standards in the process control world for signaling, as I said, we take a particular measurement that we care about, and this particular diagram is showing gallons per minute, so we're showing a flow rate. And we've got a device out there that we have calibrated to put out an electrical signal so that at 50 gallons per minute, which is the lowest flow rate we care about, and 250, which is the highest we care about, we get an electrical signal. That is the full span, a 0 to 100% range of our transmitter device, and we're going to represent that with 4 to 20 milliamp signals. And we talk about the lower measurement range or the lower range value and the upper measurement range or upper range value, the LRV and the URV. Those are the highest and lowest engineering unit values that we are going to look at coming from this transmitter device, this measurement device. And that range of engineering units is going to be represented by a 4 to 20 milliamp or a 3 to 15 psi pressure signal as a way of transmitting that signal from the sensor to the controller device. And this is what we call engineering unit range conversion. So our engineering unit range is gallons per minute. We only care about 50 to 250 gallons per minute. And that range, that lower range of 50, the upper range of 250, is going to be represented by a 4 to 20 milliamp analog signal. Incidentally, just to sort of help you understand, people say, why 4 to 20 milliamps? If you know anything about Ohm's law, Ohm's law says that you will get a voltage in volts equal to current in amperes times resistance in ohms. And a little later on, we'll find out most electrical devices will have a 250-ohm resistor. And if you put 20 milliamps through a 250-ohm resistor, you get a voltage measurement of 5 volts. If you put the same, if you put 4 milliamps through that same resistor, you get 1 volt. So actually, a 4 to 20 milliamp signal is going to generate a 1 to 5 volt electrical signal that can be measured at the far end in the actual instrument. All right, let's talk about a couple of very important terms, repeatability and accuracy. When we talk about instrumentation, it's very important that when we make a measurement, we get an accurate value. In this particular diagram, you could think of these as being, you know, actual bullseye charts on a firing range, and you've got two people both trying to shoot at and hit the bullseye, because the bullseye is the correct measurement. In other words, I have a measurement device, and I take a measurement, write it down, come back a little later, take the measurement again, write it down, take the measurement again, write it down, and the thing I'm measuring is not changing. It's holding a constant value. Well, this is the same kind of representation. This bullseye is sort of showing the variations in the measurement we took. Now, here's where we want to differentiate. The target on the right, the guy never hit the bullseye, right? The measurement is never in the bullseye. So you could argue that this guy's accuracy is not very good. After all, the guy on the right hit the bullseye, you know, 3 times, right? But there's a problem here. We're not really shooting a gun at this point. We're talking about repeatability and accuracy. Yes, the guy on the right-hand side is more accurate, and then, you know, more measurements were correct, But there's also some significant deviations. You know, in a couple of cases, the measurement we got was way off from the correct value. On the other hand, the person on the left, all of their measurements were very close together. In other words, they were inaccurate by almost a constant amount. And if you were thinking about that gun example, probably by taking the gun sight on the person on the left and making a small adjustment, this person will then be shooting every bullet right into the bullseye. Whereas the person on the right, there's no way to adjust the gun sight, shall we say, to make all those shots end up in the center. This person on the right seems to be more accurate, but unfortunately the measurements are very unrepeatable. Whereas the person on the left is highly repeatable, and therefore with a small tweak, we can probably significantly improve their accuracy. So when we talk about accuracy and repeatability, they're related to each other, but they're not quite the same thing. The person on the right seems more accurate because we got more correct measurements, but there's no way to adjust the gun sight, shall we say, or calibrate the instrument to fix and bring everything into the bullseye, whereas the person on the left, with a small tweak and adjustment of the gun sight or adjustment of the calibration of the instrument, this thing's going to give me the correct measurement pretty much every time. Now, we can represent that graphically, and that's what I've got in this diagram. In this particular diagram, as I've said, when we make a measurement, and that measurement, an engineering unit value, is then converted to using a transmitter device to an electrical signal, we're going to put out, ostensibly, a linear signal that goes from 0 to 100% of scale of whatever the engineering range is in a very linear fashion. So in these two diagrams here, the red line is the ideal output of the measurement device. At 0% of scale, I should put out nothing. At 100% of scale, I should be putting out, you know, 20 milliamps. Well, actually, at the low end, I should be putting out 4 milliamps. At the upper end, 20 milliamps. And in between, it should be completely linear. Now, in the example we had previously with the bullseye situation, the guy whose shots were pretty much all grouped together but off by a certain amount, that's represented by the upper diagram here. What we have is something called a zero error. In other words, every measurement is off by a certain fixed amount, either above or below the bullseye. That zero error can be represented by the blue and the greenish lines. We've got an offset. Well, most transmitter devices have something called a zero adjustment. I can tweak that zero adjustment and bring the blue line down or the greenish line up and correct that offset problem. Now, a different type of problem can be in gain. A gain problem is one where if we were to take a series of measurements from the low end to the high end, if our gain is too high, then we end up with a line which is above the correct line. If our gain's too low, we're down below the red line. So as we go further and further up the scale, our error gets bigger and bigger. Well, again, in most instrument devices out there, we have the ability to make a gain adjustment to correct that. So most instruments, certainly older instruments, it's less common these days, but older instruments always had a zero and span adjustment that could be used to correct for a zero or span gain offset. Now, another term we should understand is nonlinearity. Sometimes we've got a transmitter device out there that, because of component age or whatever, or it could even be a mechanical issue, is nonlinear. Nonlinear means that instead of going up and down on the red line as you increase or decrease the process measurement to take measures, you might be on the blue line or you might be on the green line, one or the other. You might be nonlinear above or nonlinear below. At the midpoint, we have the greatest error. So in other words, as we start from the low end, our error is not too big. It gets bigger and bigger, and then it decreases back to a minimal error again once we get the full scale. If that midpoint error is small enough, we might be able to accept the nonlinearity. It might not be, you know, a problem. On the other hand, if we do have a large nonlinearity there, in many cases the transmitter device cannot be calibrated to correct this and just has to be thrown out. Now, let's discuss another term. If, in fact, a measurement device, as you increase the process of measurement and it takes measures, follows the blue path above, But then as you decrease, it follows the green path down below. In other words, it's high nonlinear going up, but low nonlinear coming down. That is described in a different way. That is something we would call hysteresis. And again, hysteresis is only a problem if the midpoint errors on the going up and going down are large. If those are significant errors, then you've got a problem with hysteresis. Quite often that was more found in mechanical devices, pneumatic devices and electromechanical devices, not so much in electronic. But if you have a problem like that, if you were trying to do a calibration check on an instrument and as you went up and then went back down, you followed above and then below in these dual nonlinearities, we would say that that device has a hysteresis problem. And again, in most cases, that just means throw it away and get a new one. All right, there's a lot of other terms that we use when we talk about measurements. We talk about resolution. Well, when somebody says resolution, what they mean is the smallest scale increment. Think of that like on your gas gauge, or better yet, think about a ruler. If you've got a ruler that's been marked in tenths of inches, then trying to make a measurement that's less than tenths of inches, like hundredths of inches, is a pure guess. You know, you don't really have the ability, you're not scaled to read to that resolution. There's also a discussion of sensitivity. You could think of that as the smallest change in the process that has to occur for the sensor to react to it. So, for example, if I've got a thermocouple that I'm using to measure temperature, you know, a change of a hundredth of a degree is so small that the thermocouple won't react. You can't even see a change. So it's below our sensitivity level. We just discussed hysteresis, which is the problem of a measurement as you increase it, you get a above the correct level nonlinearity, and as you decrease it, you get a below the level. And hysteresis tended to be primarily a problem you'd see in older mechanical, pneumatic, and electromechanical devices. Then we also have dead band, and that is where you have to have a certain amount of change before anything happens. And I like to think of that as like taking up slack. I use the example of someone with a ball and chain tied to their ankle, right? As they walk across the room until they get to the length of the chain, the ball doesn't move. And then when they get to the other end and then turn direction, until they again take up the slack, the ball doesn't move. We've got a certain amount of movement before any actual change occurs in the output of the sensor device. Again, dead band tended to be primarily a problem with mechanical and pneumatic transmitter type devices. A couple of other terms, ranging, scaling, and calibration. Ranging is the process of adjusting an instrument so that its output for 4 to 20 milliamps, is representing the portion of its measurement range that you want. For example, there are thermocouples, like a J thermocouple. It can put out a measurable signal that can vary from like minus 100 degrees to several hundred degrees. But if my process is operating just over the range of water from boiling to freezing, like 0 to 100 degrees C, then I don't care about above and below that. I want to adjust my transmitter so that it puts out 4 to 20 milliamps for my 0 to 100 degree C temperature range coming out of the thermocouple. So when we range an instrument, it's picking the portion of the instrument span that we want to be represented by our 4 to 20 or 3 to 15 PSI signal. Also, it's important to note that a lot of modern digital instruments, you really don't have any need to calibrate them upon a range change. They're usually calibrated at the factory over their entire range, and all you do is tell the instrument which portion of the range you want to make use of. Now, calibration is actually where we feed a reference signal, a known standardized reference signal, into the instrument and see what it puts out and find out whether, in fact, it's inaccurate or not. It used to be that instruments had to regularly go into the instrument shop and be recalibrated, and calibration is one of the biggest problems. Again, modern digital instruments, a lot of them these days are actually self-calibrating. They've got built-in reference standards, like very precision voltages that they make a measurement of occasionally, and they check themselves. Also, smart instruments quite often have built-in calibration or linearization curves. So calibration was a big problem in the old days, but not so much one today. All right, so the key points in number two, we've talked about all these different things we might want to measure, these things we would call process variables like temperature, pressure, and flow. We've talked about using sensors combined with transmitters as an instrument to make a measurement of these variables and then to represent the range, the measurement, using, the 4 to 20 milliamp signals or 3 to 15 PSI signals. We've talked about this engineering unit representation as a percentage of scale. We discussed accuracy and repeatability and why they're not the same thing. And we talked a little bit about some of the other aspects of instrumentation. So, Tiffany, again, we're at the end of Section 2. Let me turn it over to you and see if there's any questions.
Yes, sir. At this time, again, if you would like to ask a question, please press star, then the number 1 on your telephone keypad. Again, that is star 1. We'll pause for a moment to compile the Q&A roster. And at this time, sir, there are currently no questions in queue.
All right. Thanks, Tiffany. All right, everyone, let's go ahead then and get into section number 3, where we're going to talk a bit more in detail about control loops and controllers. We're going to talk about some terminology, the meaning of something called a two-wire loop. We're going to talk about the types of output signals that are used to control elements. We'll talk about something called a transducer. We'll talk a bit about valves and valve actuators, and we're going to talk about controllers and discuss probably the two primary forms of control algorithms used in process control, on-off, or also called bang-bang control, and PID control, proportional, integral, and derivative control. And we'll finish up with a little bit of a discussion about controller loop tuning. All right, in this diagram, we have a very typical example of a process instrumentation loop. The pink pipe represents some liquid that's flowing, and we want to control its flow rate. We want to maintain the flow rate at a desired value, our set point value. Right? To do that, we have a valve. This is on the right hand or the left hand side of the diagram. We have a final control element, which is a flow control valve, and this is an adjustable valve. This valve has a stem that sort of sticks down into the valve, and that stem can be raised and lowered to either completely close off or totally open the valve or anywhere in between. So we can adjust that valve to be a little bit open or a little bit closed or all the way open, all the way closed. Think of it pretty much the same way that a hot water or cold water valve in your shower, where you can turn it to the left all the way or turn it to the right all the way, but you can also make small adjustments. Well, that's what this valve is, except to control that valve, we don't reach into it with our hand and twist it and turn it. The valve has an actuator, and this is this blue stuff. The valve has an actuator, and we'll talk about what that is, but essentially it's a diaphragm. Think of it like a circular piece of metal that has air pressure placed on one side of it, and it can bend. It can press down based on the amount of pressure we put above it. And so by adjusting air pressure, we can push downwards or come back upwards and make that valve stem go further in or further out of the valve, thus adjusting the flow. Now, to do that, we need air pressure. But let's go back to the other side of the loop. So we've got the valve that's going to be adjustable to control the flow through that pink pipe. But in order to adjust it and control flow, we have to measure it. So on the right-hand side down at the bottom, we have in the middle of the pipe something called an orifice plate. And I mentioned this earlier. Essentially, it's a round piece of metal with a hole cut in it so that it partially blocks flow. And we've bolted it in the middle of the pipe. So as the liquid flows through the pipe, it hits that orifice plate and then squeezes through and keeps on going. But there's a pressure on one side of the pipe, on one side of the orifice plate, and a pressure on the other side. And we've got little pipes, little impulse lines, as they're called, that come down from both sides of that orifice plate, and they come into a transmitter, a differential pressure transmitter. This is something where we take that pressure difference, the pressure from one side and the other, we put it across this device, and this device puts out an electrical signal. So coming out of this pressure transmitter is a 4 to 20 milliampere signal, and it's going up a pair of wires. That's the yellow portion. So this 4 to 20 milliamp signal that's coming out of this transmitter is going into this green square at the top center, which is our process controller. And in that controller, there's actually a 250 ohm resistor, and the current flows through that resistor. And again, if we do a little calculation with Ohm's law, we'll find that at 4 milliamps, the voltage across that resistor is 1 volt, And when we get up to 20 milliamps, the voltage across that resistor is 5 volts. So the controller is actually watching the voltage across that resistor, and it can convert that voltage into a signal because we've agreed, we've calibrated the transmitter, and we said that that transmitter will put out, let's say, 0 to 50 gallons per minute, represented by 4 to 20 milliamps, or by 1 to 5 volts. So by measuring the voltage, I can make a determination of what the flow rate is that the transmitter is measuring. So that's my measured variable or my input to the controller. Now, we're not showing it on this diagram, but on the front of the controller somewhere, we've adjusted and set in a set point. So let's assume that that 100 we see on the front is the desired set point value. So we've dialed in a desired flow rate of 100 gallons per minute. So we're measuring the actual flow using that transmitter, and which is sending the signal using 4 to 20 milliamps into the controller. So the controller has a measurement of the flow. It knows that we want a flow rate of 100 gallons per minute. If they our measurement and the set point are the same, then we have no error. And therefore, whatever the current position of that valve, whatever, you know, how far open or closed it is, must be just fine. So we are not going to change anything. And in fact, the controller is putting out an electrical signal. That's our output. And that is, again, two wires, and that's going to this little box called an I2P. Well, an I2P is a device that you put a 4 to 20 milliamp electrical signal into it. You also feed it with high-pressure air, and what it puts out is a pressure, air pressure signal that will vary between 3 to 15 psi, or 20 to 100 kilopascals if you're European, based on putting into the I2P a 4 to 20 milliamp signal. So my analog inputs and outputs to the controller are 4 to 20 milliamps, but I have to generate an air signal to control that valve actuator, so I use an I2P, a transducer, to convert my electrical output to something that will move the valve. So this is my control loop. I've got all my components. I'm making a measurement. I'm turning that measurement into an electrical signal and sending it over two wires to a controller as its measured input. I dial in a set point on the controller, and then the controller sends out a control output to manipulate the position of a valve as a 4 to 20 milliamp signal, and then that's converted to air pressure, which is what I really need to operate the valve. This is a very typical example of a real-life process control loop with all the different elements required. And obviously, my valve actuator needs to be properly calibrated. My transmitter needs to be properly calibrated so that in the case of the valve, it's fully open or fully closed for 4 to 20 milliamp output signal, and in the case of the transmitter, that's putting out the right pressure signal for the 4 to 20 milliamps. All right, transducer. We just saw an example. Transducer, just as you know, the word means convert from one form to another. Many of the final control elements in continuous control are valves, and quite often they're valves that you know are adjustable. In other words, not just open and closed, but I can adjust them anywhere in between, just like that hand-operated valve you've got on the hot water in your shower. But in most cases, these valves have what's called a pneumatic actuator, something where I put air pressure in, and if I put in more pressure or less pressure, the valve opens more or closes more. Again, most controllers these days, certainly, you know, if you're talking about PLCs or a DCS system or any kind of microprocessor-based panel instrument, these are electronic. They don't put out air pressure. They put out an electrical signal, and they generally use the standard 4 to 20 milliamp signal. So we use a transducer, an I2P, to convert from one to the other. And incidentally, in some cases, we'll need a P to I because there are measurement devices that put out an air pressure signal. And for it to go into my controller, it's got to be turned into electrical. So sometimes I need a P to I transducer on my inputs to convert a pressure signal to a voltage signal, or a current signal, I should say, that can be read by my controller. Now, what is an I2P? Well, it's a huffing, puffing chunk of mechanical stuff. I'm not a mechanical engineer. The diagram here shows a very highly simplified cutaway diagram. The important thing to recognize is on the left-hand side, I show something called air supply and output. Air supply means I've got to have a source of continuous, somewhat high-pressure instrument air that flows into this device. And then this device adjusts a valve inside of it to control the airflow out of it, and its output is again going to put out a 3 to 15 PSI signal. Now, how do we adjust that? Well, inside this device, there is a lever arm. It's literally a little teeter-totter, a lever arm that is pulled one way or the other by an electromagnet. So when I put my 4 to 20 milliamp signal into this thing, that current flow actually runs through an electromagnet, and the more current I put through it, the stronger the magnet pull, and this magnet is pulling against a balance beam, an arm, to try and pull it further one way or the other, and as it pulls it in and out, that changes the pressure against something called a flapper valve or nozzle. And again, I'm not going to go into the mechanical aspects of it, but trust me, it's possible to take this device and calibrate it and adjust it so that as I put in 4 to 20 milliampere electrical signal, what it puts out is a 3 to 15 PSI air pressure signal. And an I to P like this is very commonly going to be found out by your valves to convert that electrical signal that's coming out from my control room, from my controller, into an air pressure signal that can be used to operate a valve. And again, there's similar devices that work in the opposite direction that will convert pressure into an electrical signal. Now, what about the valves themselves? Control valves have typically two parts. There's the valve body that actually, you know, allows you to put liquids in, and then it, you know, partially or completely or anywhere in between chokes off the flow. And then there's something called the actuator or the valve head, the thing that manipulates it. Sometimes the actuator is an actual handle because it's a manual valve and you have to walk up to it and turn it. But in most cases, for process control purposes, it's going to have an actuator that we can send an electrical signal to or an air pressure signal to. Now, the type of valve can be indicated on a P&I diagram by the symbol we use. And in this particular diagram, I've got two types of valves. I've got a single-seated globe valve, and the symbol below it indicates that it's a globe valve. Actually, that circle in the middle of the valve symbol tells me it's a globe valve. Then I also have next to it a rotary valve, or sometimes called a butterfly valve. And there's the symbol for that type of valve. So if I look on a P&I diagram, the symbol for a valve will tell me what type it is. Now, right here, we're showing you the symbol for the valve itself, not for the actual actuator. Stem valves like this globe valve, it's a cutaway, so it's not as easy to see, but in the middle of that valve, there's a seat through which the liquid has to come from the bottom, flow up through and then out. And there's a plug that can be pushed up and down to sort of plug off that flow entirely or to back away from that plug and let more and more flow. And that stem, that vertical line in the middle, is actually a stem, a valve stem, that can be pushed in and out to adjust the flow rate. With a rotary valve, on the other hand, we have a shaft that has to be rotated to sort of flip the valve sideways for full open or flip it vertically for full close. That type of valve tends to be used in very big applications. For example, a rotary valve might be 2 feet across or 3 feet across, and the actuator there is quite often an actual electrical motor with a gearing so that I can drive that valve one way or the other. In this next diagram, I'm showing you the actual actuator, and this is the actuator symbol on the left-hand side. So the valve body is drawn one way, and then the actuator is drawn differently. In this case, the semicircle indicates that this is a pneumatically operated diaphragm valve. And what we've got here is a drawing that shows the body of the valve itself, showing the plug and showing the stem that comes up out of the valve body. And then on top of it, a cutaway of the actuator. And in fact, what the actuator is, again, a circle of metal, this diaphragm. It's a circular piece of metal that has a set of concentric ripples so that it can flex. And it is sort of bolted in the middle of the top of this valve. And coming in from the top is an air pressure signal. And then that diaphragm below has a shaft, the stem, which is being supported by a spring. So what's not indicated here is in the body down below is a spring. So if you think about it, as I put more and more air pressure into the top, it causes the diaphragm to buckle downwards, pushing the stem downwards, and in this particular case, closing off or shutting down the flow. If I were to take all the air pressure away, the spring would push the diaphragm back up, and the plug would pop up and open the valve all the way. So this is a fail open valve. This is a valve where if I lose my air pressure signal, the valve will pop open because the spring will cause that to happen. So this is a typical example of a pneumatically operated actuator and a valve connected to it. Now, in this next diagram, I show that in a little bit more detail. I show the top, the diaphragm, and it's inside that purple area, and then we see the stem. And quite often with valves of this type, on the stem there will be a little pointer that tells you if you walk up, you can see whether the valve is anywhere between, you know, full open or full closed or somewhere in between. And again, most of these kind of valves are air operated, so there will be an air supply to the valve, the built-in sort of I to P capability, and then an input. So what you don't quite get from the picture is that piece off to the right is an I to P transducer. So we've got the input, which is my 3 to 15 PSI signal, and then we've got the air supply in, which is the higher pressure air, and then this thing will adjust the valve anywhere between full open and full closed based on that 3 to 15 PSI input. All right. Controllers. I mentioned before that when we talk about control, we're really talking about whether the measurement we're making of temperature, pressure, the measured variable, is at the desired value, which we call the set point. So in the world of process control, we talk about the difference between the set point and the measured variable as being what we call the error. And the error is going to cause us to take control action. Now, there are two ways of computing the difference between set point and measurement. One is set point minus measurement. The other is measurement minus set point. The reason for these two differences is what's called reverse acting and direct acting. In a reverse acting controller where we say that error is set point minus measurement, if the measurement value increases above the set point, then the error actually gets smaller. So it's going in the opposite direction. In other words, the control output decreases as the measurement value increases above the set point. In direct acting, as the measured variable decreases, then the output decreases. Or if the measured variable increases, the output increases. So we call that direct acting. Sometimes you need a direct acting. Sometimes you need a reverse acting. A couple of examples. My case of the hot water heater and the shower temperature. If your temperature of the hot water is increasing, you don't open the hot water heater or the hot water valve more. You close it. So you want reverse acting. So as my measurement of temperature goes up in the shower, I decrease the output, so I have a reverse acting. On the other hand, if I were in a car sliding down a hillside, rolling down a hillside, and I was trying to maintain speed, as my speed picks up, my measured variable, I want the amount of braking pressure to increase to slow me down. So in that particular case, the control action would be direct acting. Now, the most fundamental type of control, and one that we use all the time, is something called on-off or bang-bang control. It's called bang-bang control because if you've ever been in a process plant where they're controlling a valve using this, as you're standing next to the valve, it'll bang, slam full closed, and then bang, slam full open, and it really can be very noisy. But bang-bang or on-off control is very commonly used. This is exactly how your hot water heater works. This is exactly how the oven temperature controller works. This is exactly how, for the most part, your furnace works. In bang-bang or on-off control, we have a desired value. If we fall below that, we turn something on. Once we go above it, we turn something back off. Since we don't want to beat this device, let's say it's a valve, to death by small variations, we usually allow something called a dead band around it. In other words, don't turn it on until you go, you know, more than so much above the set point. And then once we come back, don't turn it off until we go a certain amount beyond the dead point, or beyond the set point. So, because if we didn't, we'd be sitting right at the set point and making teeny little changes above and below and banging the valve open and closed, and the valve wouldn't last more than about a day. So we usually have a dead band. And so what it says is that our measured variable, our controlled variable, is never generally sitting right at where we want. It's usually cycling around where we want. And this is exactly what happens in your oven. You know, you set this oven to 450. It's very rare that your actual temperature in the oven is at 450. It's probably cycling between 10 to 20 degrees above and 10 to 20 degrees below, constantly up and down and up and down. So on-off or bang-bang control is the most basic type of control, and it's very simple. If my air is non-zero, in other words, my air is greater than zero, then in theory I'm going to turn something on or open something or start something, and if it falls back to zero, I'll turn it the other way. Again, we put this dead band around it so that we don't beat our equipment to death, so that it says the air has to exceed a certain amount before we actually take the control action, and it's far more common. But bang-bang or on-off control, you know, can be useful for certain things, but it's certainly not considered to be a high-quality form of process control. What we generally tend to do in most modern controllers is some variation on what's called the PID, or proportional integral derivative control. So PID control is far more common. PID controller has three pieces to it. The first piece is called proportional, and proportional means just that. If I have a difference between the set point and my measurement, in other words, I have an error, then I'm going to change my output by a certain amount. And that amount is usually the error times some constant, some gain adjustment. So if I have an error of 1% and my gain adjustment is 5, I'm going to change my output by 5%. So the bigger the error, the bigger the output. Now, proportional control is the primary thing in most control algorithms that tries to send us back in the right direction. So it's like in the shower when somebody flushed that toilet and suddenly the temperature goes way up and you quickly turn that hot water valve a quarter turn. Now, is that going to get you exactly where you want? Probably not. You know, in a short second or two after, you're going to say, yeah, I went too far, or I didn't go far enough, and you're going to start making small adjustments. Well, to do that, we have the second term in our PID controller, the integral term. The integral term is there principally so that when we suddenly have an error and we make a proportional adjustment in our output, and that gets us headed back in the right direction, but not all the way where we want to continue to make small additional adjustments as long as we're not where we want it to be. So if the water is still not at the temperature I want, still a little too hot or still a little too cold, I want to continue to make some adjustments. So the purpose of the integral term is to basically, as it says, eliminate that small offset that occurs after you take our proportional action to slowly bring us back to the correct value, because quite often the proportional won't take us all the way back to where we need. It'll take us close, but the integral needs to walk us all the way back. Now, the third term, the derivative term, is probably the one that's least understood. The derivative, sometimes called the derivative kick, only takes action when there's a change in the error. You can see it's derivative, right? It's the change d by dt of the error. So it only has an effect if the error changes. So once I have an error, when I initially generate an error, maybe my temperature just jumped up, then the derivative term is going to contribute to the output. It's going to give us a kick of additional output. But then the second later, the error hasn't changed, and therefore the derivative is zero, and therefore the derivative term contributes nothing. So quite often the derivative aspect of the PID algorithm is used when we have slow processes to give us an initial kick in one direction or the other to reduce, over, or undershoot. You might say it's a momentary one-shot adjustment to the amount of output change given to us by the proportional band. So you might think of it as a one-shot quick adjustment to proportional band that then sort of fades off unless the error keeps changing, because it works on the rate of change of the error. Now, a lot of people find it difficult to understand the three terms, and certainly in just an hour's time we're not going to be able to go into them completely. But I want you to understand that a modern controller typically runs what's called the PID algorithm. The algorithm is this equation you see here, although done in usually a digital form, and that it has three portions to it. It has a proportional piece that gives us a change of output directly related or proportional to the amount of error. It has an integral term that kicks in and continues then to walk us back where we need to be, and a derivative term that usually gives us an initial kick one way or the other to either get a little additional control action or a little less additional control action, basically to make sure we don't overshoot or undershoot. Now, when we talk about a control algorithm, one of the most important things about a control algorithm is tuning. In that PID equation, there were three tuning constants. There was a gain constant. Sometimes you hear people talk about proportional band. That's the inverse of the gain. There was an integral time adjustment, and there was a derivative time adjustment. In other words, these are values, parameters you can manipulate and adjust that will cause your controller to take different amounts of action. And if you get those wrong, it can be very bad. In fact, if you get those constants tuned incorrectly, you can end up with your process oscillating all over the place and going out of control. Ideally, if we have a perturbation in the process, and on this diagram on the left-hand side, we're showing the process coming along at a certain level, and then we have a step change. Again, that could be the case of somebody flushing the toilet, right, or turning on the water in the kitchen, and suddenly your temperature goes up. Your controller now wants to make an adjustment. It wants to take a quick kick of the hot water valve based on the proportional band, and then as you realize you're not quite where you need to be, then start adding some interval and tweaking that valve some more. When we talk about proper tuning, what we mean is that when we have a perturbation in the or step function change in the process measurement, that we get it back to where we want it to be as quickly as possible without overshooting any more than necessary. And usually we refer to proper tuning of a controller as having proper quarter wave damping. And what does that mean? Well, as you can see on the right-hand side up top, my process measurement exceeds my desired set point value because we went a little too far in our adjustment, so we got to tweak back a little bit. And then we go down a little too far and we tweak back a little bit more and we come back and forth. The point is that at each successive, shall we say, overshoot, the amplitude of the overshoot should be a quarter of the amplitude of the prior overshoot, so that after literally four oscillations, we're pretty much back to where we wanted to be in our set point measurement are there, and we haven't gone into any crazy oscillation. So in process control terminology, when we talk about properly tuning our controller, what it means is we've adjusted our proportional, integral, and derivative constants to achieve quarter wave damping. So again, there are three different basic types of control action. There's the on-off or bang-bang control, and then there's the proportional, integral, and derivative. And it should be understood that in a PID controller, you don't always have to use all three. There are people who are out there using strictly proportional only. The most common is a combination of proportional and integral. And then for certain processes and certain types of plant environments, it actually makes sense to use proportional, integral, and derivative, but you'll see combinations of all three. All right, so we've just finished up section three. We've talked about two-wire loops where we put a 4 to 20 milliamp signal down through a loop of wire, and it goes through a resistor and gives us an electrical signal that can be measured by a controller. We've talked about using the same 4 to 20 milliamp output to control our valves and our final control elements, and we've talked about using transducers to turn electrical signals into pressure signals and the other in back and forth as well. We talked about valves and their actuators and control actions, and again, the on-off or bang-bang control action like your oven and your hot water heater use, and the proportional, proportional integral, or proportional integral derivative combinations that can be used in regular process control, and also the notion of needing to properly tune those control actions so that we could quarter-wave damping. All right, that brings us to the point in this presentation where we are going to ask you about the people at your site. We know how many people, we know how many sites have been signed up, but we do want you to basically indicate to us by, clicking on the slide, the appropriate icon, to indicate to us how many people are at your site. So I'm going to give you a second or two here to click on the left-hand side, one of those colored tabs, and let us know how many people you've actually got there today. All right, looks like I think we've got everybody's information, so we appreciate that. All right, so let's go on and finish this up. We're at the end of three. So, Tiffany, let me again turn it back to you, and let's see if there's any questions either on section three or anything else we've covered today.
At this time, if you would like to ask a question, please press star, then the number one on your telephone keypad. Again, that is star, then the number one. We'll pause for a moment to compile the Q&A roster. And at this time, sir, there are currently no questions in queue.
All right, then. And let me go ahead and take us to the end. Thank you for attending today. We really do appreciate your participation. I do want to mention that the ISA has quite a few courses. Some of them are taught down at the ISA facility. Some of them can be taught at your site. Related to what we're talking about today, there is a good one-week course called FG07, which is an introduction to industrial automation control, where you actually get your hands on some of the stuff. TC05 will teach about control loops and tuning of those loops. And, of course, TS00 allows you to take a review course in case you want to become a certified control system technician. And, of course, you can contact the ISA if you're interested in any of this. The ISA also offers a couple of different certifications. There is a Certified Automation Professional, or CAP, certification, or, as I just mentioned, a Certified Control Systems Technician. Again, if you're interested, contact the ISA. We have sent out as part of your package a webinar survey by Zoomerang. We would like you to please remember to fill that thing out. Your feedback is important to us, and it helps us to improve our courses. Let me hand you back to Tiffany, who can finish us up.
This concludes today's ISA web seminar. Please do not forget to fill out the evaluation survey found in your email inbox. Thank you for attending, and have a nice day.